That was a blessing. Music is a beautiful thing. It is something that works in the very core of our being. It is like, there are other things like this. Have you ever noticed how when you go somewhere and you smell a particular aroma, how instantaneously you're transported back in time to another place? Music can have the same effect. It works at such a different level. Thank you very much. This is quite, that's very well. So, but song, as it worked for Saul, can work in our hearts in a way that perhaps the spoken word cannot. So thank you very much for the beautiful music. The clicker works. One of the things I like about this time of year is that if somebody asks you to speak, have a sermon topic, and you have a part of the Bible you can always go to and be safe. Not only do we have great music this time of year, but we also can talk about the story of Jesus Christ. And what's even better is we can talk about Jesus Christ to some people that maybe in July wouldn't be that interested in hearing the story. This is a little bit more of a public kind of a thing. In any case, this time, I'm going to start off reading, we're reading in Luke today for the most part. And Jay read somewhere further down, but we're just going to read the start here. This is fairly familiar territory. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place when Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and the line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped them in cloths and placed them in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with an angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us all about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what they had been told about this child. And all who heard it were amazed. The shepherd said to them, "But Mary treasured all these things and pondered them in her heart." The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we ask that you be here with your Holy Spirit, and Lord, that the things that are spoken do not come from me, but from you. In Jesus' name. Amen. So, some time ago, Pastor Tassiana and Pastor Berman, her father, they were here, and her father told a little story. And I'm actually going to ask somebody to try and help me remember this, because I don't remember what it was, but when she was young, she asked him one day when he was going to preach, "Daddy, can you mention such and so somewhere in your sermon?" And it was like a little secret between them. She mentioned something that she wanted him to bury in his sermon somewhere. Sure enough, he did that. And for the life of me, I cannot remember. What was this? Does somebody here remember what it was that he was going to mention in the sermon that he did? Nobody can remember that. I texted her and I asked her. They didn't answer. She'll give me the answer tonight, probably. So it's could be a little too late for this purpose. In any case, Janelle, the same day, said to me, joking around, well, can you include my cat in your next sermon? I said, okay, we'll have to do that. It's gonna be seamless. Nobody will even notice. It's just gonna happen. And people will just be amazed that somehow the cat had something to do with the sermon. Now, this is Janelle's cat, and her name from the pet rescue people is Carol. And we have Carol right here, and Janelle deemed that to not be a kitten name, though. And so she called her Kit Kat. And there we are, and Kit Kat brings Janelle great joy. Brings us all great joy. Now, this cat reminds me of a situation a long time ago. It was probably 7 years ago. My wife was teaching piano at home, and she had some piano students there, and one of the piano students, it was Yana, yes, that's the name. Knos, thank you very much. The Greek name was escaping me. She was telling me all kinds of things about cats. We were having this great discussion. She was playing with one. She was saying she didn't know how to hold the cat. I said, there's nothing to it. Pick it up and we'll let you know if it has a problem. And she was just, at that time, she was like 9, and she just loved everything about cats. And so I told her the story of a cat that we had many, many years ago. One day, I was at work. This is probably 2000. I was at work, doing my thing at work, and the phone rings, and I pick it up and answer it in a very business-like tone, of course, and it's my wife. And she says she was with Andrew, and they went out. And I hear Andrew in the background, and his little boy voice saying, we have a kitten! Okay, so the cat's out of the back of my way. There was no secret there. She'd been trying to prepare me. There was no preparation needed. Andrew just said it flat out, we have a kitten! And so I'm telling Yana this story of this kitten. And Andrew was so happy, he'd asked for a boy cat, and they found him a little boy kitten and brought him home. He named him Milo from Milo Notice. And it was something, he was just so happy. And all week long, we're playing with Milo, doing this and that, and he's crawling under stuff and meowing a lot. Cute little thing. Well, what happened was, I want to even show you. There's Milo, and you see Beth, and there's Andrew. He's not 25 in this picture. In any case, about a week later, I was holding Milo in my hands, and I walk over to the light, and I'm looking at him. Turning him over, I'm looking at him in the light. I'm looking closer. I look a little closer. I said, hey, Andrew, we got a problem. You gotta choose another name for this cat. You can't call her Milo. This is a girl. And at this point, when I'm telling this story to Yana, she looked at me and she said, how did you know? How did you know that she wasn't a boy? And I'm thinking, wow. I painted myself in a corner with this one, didn't I? I don't think it's my particular job at this point in time to have a long description of how you can tell. Janelle solved the problem for me. She simply said, oh, you tell the same way you tell if a newborn baby is a boy or a girl. And that was that. No further questions. Nobody even worried about it. I'm sure Yana today, she's got to be 17, 18 by now. I bet you she figured this one out. In any case, we are all different. Every one of us is different. They're always distinguishable. And what's really cool is we come in all these different colors, mostly earth tones. But you look at all these smiling faces. You just look at the face, you know if it's a boy or a girl. There's no question about that. We're so distinct. But it's not the same with babies. It's all the same. I'm a guy, and when I'm at work and some woman is showing baby pictures, grandchild or child, Everybody's around looking at him and saying, wow, beautiful. And I look and I say, it's a baby. People don't say that, it's not nice, but I say, oh, what a beautiful baby. But I'm thinking, it's a baby. They all look the same. What's really cool is what's inside those babies is everything needed to form the complete individual many years later. It's all there, but nobody can see it. Now let's take a look at what was happening at the time when Jesus was at an old, 10 days old. These are maybe younger, but 10 days old. Let's go back to Luke 22-38. So he's 10. This is 10 days. This is time for the purification offering, as required by the law of Moses after the birth of a child. So his parents took him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. The law of the Lord says, if a woman's first child is a boy, he must be dedicated to the Lord. So they offer a sacrifice required in the law of the Lord, either a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. At that time, there was a man in Jerusalem named Simeon. He was righteous and devout and eagerly awaiting for the Messiah to come and rescue Israel. The Holy Spirit was upon him and had revealed to him that he would not die until he had seen the Lord's Messiah. That day, the Spirit led him to the temple. So when Mary and Joseph came to present the baby Jesus to the Lord, as the law required, Simeon was there. He took the child in his arms and praised God, saying, Sovereign Lord, now let your servant die in peace, as you have promised. I have seen your salvation, which you have prepared for all people. He is a light to reveal God to the nations, and he is the glory of your people, Israel. Jesus' parents were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, the baby's mother, This child is destined to cause many in Israel to fall and many others to rise. He has been set as a sign from God, but many will oppose him. As a result, the deepest thoughts of many hearts will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your very soul. Anna, a prophet, was also there in the temple. She was the daughter of Phanuel. I hope I said that close. From the tribe of Asher, and she was very old. Her husband died when they had been married only 7 years. Then she lived as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but stayed there day and night, worshiping God with fasting and prayer. She came along just as Simeon was talking with Mary and Joseph. She began praising God. She talked about the child, everyone who had been waiting expectantly for God to rescue Jerusalem. And so there we go. And I assume that this is a sitting right there, holy baby Jesus. Let's place ourselves in this story. 400 years before Jesus was born, 400 years, Israel was without a prophet. In the 400 years that preceded Jesus Christ, there were no prophets. God did not speak to anyone and say to him, you need to take my message to the people. Nobody stood up and said, following the word of God, I say, this is so. How old is the Seventh-day Adventist Church? How many people know? How old? How many years? Old, 150. 400 years, that's a long time. Israel had a history of God choosing prophets, directing his message to people through the prophets. But now 400 years had passed since God had become quiet. He didn't speak to another prophet. He didn't say anything more. What do you think 400 years ago, our 400 years ago, would have been like to us? What's the longest time ago in the past that you can remember, that you can imagine? So you know how the 1960s were like all in a crazy faded color, and of course the 1950s, you know, they were black and white. And as far as I know, in the 30s, people were black and white, talk fast, and always had a cigarette beside their mouth or something like that. But that's the image that we may have of these times, but they were very real. If I try to think of Somebody who might have been around and might know some stories from a long time ago. How many people know who that man is, the old man in the center there? A couple people recognize him. He's a church member here. His name is Miliband. The far left is a photograph of him probably in the 1930s. He's there with Corey and Maritza. I forget the name of the gentleman behind him, but they were. This picture was taken in 1993 or 1994. He was a man who really walked the walk. So it's an honor to know. He passed away several years ago. His wife comes here once a year with her sister. And he told a story once in church about World War II, being in a German prison camp. And he was from Yugoslavia, and he was in jail. And he did the unthinkable, terrible act, and he wrote his name on the wall. And the prison guards saw him, and apparently in a Nazi prison you don't do that because they put him in solitary confinement. Something happened that night. The American bombers went over the town. One of the bombs missed the town they were bombing and hit the prison. Where do you think that bomb exploded? What part of the prison? His cell, where he should have been, was destroyed. So what an amazing story. And that was one of his testimonies. Had he not gotten busted for writing his name on the wall, he would have been there. That bomb would have hit. He would have been dead. Well, he didn't die, and there he is. Long time ago, he probably had memories of people way from the past. I also remember another gentleman, Ed McDowney. He was one of our elders, and he told stories of D-Day. He was African-American, so he did not fight. He was in services. He drove trucks on what's called the Red Ball Express, delivering things for the invasion, stuff like that. And anybody who knows Ed McDowney knows how old he was. He passed several years ago as well. I'm pretty confident that he would have known somebody who had been a slave in their lifetime. If you go back and you think about an old person when he was alive, they would have definitely been born before the Civil War. Well, that's not close to 400 years, is it? 400 years for us would have been in the 1600s. And things weren't even black and white there. It was probably just etchings or something. I don't know what they did back then. But certainly very difficult to place our minds and get your head around that. Imagine, though, the situation where Israel was. 400 years had gone by. So, and also imagine if I came up here today and I said, listen, this message came from God. He told me to give you this message. He also revealed to me, he said to me, Dad, he said, you will not die until you see Jesus Christ. What would you think about that? You either think, well, that's good. He's got a gray beard. He's kind of old, so he'll die soon, and Jesus will come. That's great. You're a young person. Or you could say, this is a weird sermon. Where's he going with this? What do you think would have happened had Simeon said the very same words? And the situation was very similar. If Simeon had told anybody that God had promised him, after 400 years, God said, I won't die until I see the Messiah, what do you think the pressure on the minds of the people around him would have been? How long had people been waiting for the Messiah? Any idea? If Simeon's time, that scene right there, how long had they been waiting? How many years? Four something.
4,000.
Messiah had been promised in Eden. The story of the woman, the descendant of the woman, stepping on the serpent's head. This is a promise from 4,000 years ago. For us, Jesus Christ's return was a promise from 2,000 years ago. So, very similar. And if you look, so the people around him were living a similar life to the people around us. What they had was prophecies telling that he was coming. They had all kinds of things happening in Israel. Of course, you got all the people say, this is all, they've been saying this for 4,000 years, it's not going to happen. But then you have other people. There was this thing called the Pax Romana. Anybody ever heard of that? It's a special period of Roman peace. And it started, they say, about 27 BC, and it went on for a few hundred years. Very special time in history where it was very peaceful. And there were many other things that were happening at the same time. The prophets said Jeremiah, Daniel, Isaiah, the people could be saying, we're living in the times, he's coming, he's going to be here soon. And the people would have been living their lives just as if he weren't alive, even though they knew he was coming. And then one day, Simeon shows up. And who came into the temple? Three people. Joseph, Mary, and Jesus. And who were they to the people around them? Nobody. Somebody rings the doorbell, and you go to the doorbell, you answer it. Go outside, have a few words, 3 minutes, 4 minutes pass by. Come in, and your wife says, who is that? And you answer, nobody. It was nobody. It was just some random dude wanted to talk about my cable TV or something. But the answer is nobody. And of course, he's like, you were there 3 minutes. Of course, it could be nobody. But as far as I'm concerned, to me, that person is nobody. And that is who entered the temple. Three nobodies. Nobody knew who Joseph was. Nobody knew who Mary was. And nobody knew who Jesus was. It wasn't the case for Simeon. The priest did what the priest did for all children. He saw all these babies, a whole stream of babies coming through every single day. It was just a process. But Simeon, he knew better. How many babies do you think would have been covered by this law on a daily basis? How many would have been going through there? How many times, the Bible doesn't really say if Simeon was there on other days, or if this was one single day where the Spirit tapped him on the shoulder and said, time to go. He could have been going there for many years. How many thousands and thousands of not so unique looking babies did he see until the right one came through? But he knew. The Scripture doesn't tell us much about his activities. Two things stand out. One of them, he had been given a promise. And he had the faith that the promise would be fulfilled. And one way or another, Simeon knew that this particular 10-day-old infant was the promised Savior. Simeon was not alone. He was there with Anna. She never left the temple. She worshipped day and night, fasting and praying. This is what we know about her. Very little. She was very dedicated to her work, never leaving the temple. And she also knew exactly who the child was. And she spoke to all around her about the redemption that would come through the child. So she was an old widow, faithful to the temple. She spent day and night worshiping and praying. She was faithful to custom, worship, and service. These were the external and the visible things in her life. In other words, she was there at the temple. She was doing these things daily. And she had less help in her understanding than we do. She was living in the shadows of the Old Testament, the Old Law, but she still held on to the faith, by faith, to the promise. How tired do you think she must have gotten of this? She was in her 80s. She'd been doing this for many, many, many years. She held on in spite of her weariness, her faith, and her hope. It must have been tried to the utmost. When was God going to fulfill his promise? The Bible says, she departed not, but fasted, prayed, and served. A long obedience in the same direction. A long and patient waiting. Sure that the promise of God would come. Do not tarry. And think of Simeon. He wasn't spending all of his time at the temple, but he's an example of inward faithfulness to grace and the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Bible says he came by the Spirit into the temple to answer inward call.
What was it that led him into the temple?
Just at that moment, when that couple came to present their child. How many years had Simeon waited for an answer from God's Spirit? How many years had he lived in expectation? Corresponding with grace, quiet waiting, trusting, listening for the invitation and the promise. He made no fuss. He said nothing. And suddenly now, the long-awaited moment, the long-expected meeting, Simeon and Anna are two shining examples of what it means to wait on God. Both Simeon and Anna had dedication to their work. They held on to a promise with a definite goal. They had a lifelong commitment to work and performed their duties faithfully every day. And they did not know when they would be needed. They could have performed these tasks 5 years before, 5 years later. They didn't know exactly when Jesus was going to come. And we have a little bit more than they have. We have a complete Bible. We have the New Testament. There's promises in the New Testament that they did not have available to them. The Bible tells us very clearly by Christ, spoken by Christ, that he will come again. There's nothing secret about it. Take a few of these verses. Revelation 1:7. Look, he comes with the clouds of heaven, and everyone will see him, even those who pierce him. And all the nations of the world will mourn for him. Yes, amen. 1 Thessalonians 4:16, 17. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a commanding shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet call of God. First, the Christians who have died will rise from the graves. Then together with them, we who are still alive and remain on the earth will be caught up in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Then we will be with the Lord forever. Matthew 24. Then if anyone tells you, look, here is the Messiah, or there he is, don't believe it. For false messiahs and false prophets will rise up and perform great signs and wonders, so as to deceive, if possible, even God's chosen ones. See, I warned you about this ahead of time. So if someone tells you, look, the Messiah is out in the desert, don't bother to go and look. Or look, he's hiding here, don't believe it. For as the lightning flashes in the east and shines in the west, so it will be when the Son of Man comes. And the last, and then at last, the sign of the Son of Man's coming will appear in heavens. There will be a deep warning among the peoples of the earth. And they will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he will send out his angels with mighty blast of a trumpet, and they will gather his chosen ones from all over the world, from the farthest ends of the earth and heaven. In closing, just remember that we have the whole Bible. They didn't have that. They didn't have half of it, and we have the whole Bible. It's a special privilege we have. They didn't waver. They kept going, focused on the goal. They kept doing that for decades. We have the promise of Jesus' return. The fact that their promise was fulfilled and that he came gives us more faith in the promise that he's going to return. This season, this is a time when we remember his coming. We look forward to the time when he'll come again, take us home. And we must be always ready. Closing hymn. 269, come Holy Spirit.